Good evening, or good morning, or good afternoon. Welcome, or welcome back to another episode of Tuesday's Wine and Crime ASMR. It's True Crime ASMR. Invite you to join me for a cup of coffee or a glass of wine or a glass of juice, whatever you like, and listen to another story, Tuesday's Wine and Crime ASMR is about old cases or old unsolved cases. So find yourself a cozy spot, pour yourself a glass of wine or a glass of milk or a glass of sparkle water or a cup of tea, whatever you like. I have some wine here. It's a glass of Lambrusco. It's a sparkly wine. It's fruity and sweet. It's absolutely perfect for a rainy day. Now, chin chin. Story that I'm going to tell you tonight takes us back in time in 1963 in Rome, a period when Italy difficult years after the World War II. It was a period that was called La Dolce Vita. La Dolce Vita. Let's go back in time. So it is 2nd of May 1963 in Rome. We are in Via Emilia Street, next to the famous Veneto Street, Via Veneto, La Dolce Vita Street. It is 2:30 in the afternoon. A beautiful girl named Krista Wanninger is walking in the street. She is blonde, attractive, very young. She is only 23 years old. She is going to a block of flats in Via Emilia. As usual, she's going to meet her best friend, Gerda Hoda. Krista Wanninger is a German girl who came in Rome to follow a dream. Back then, Rome was the capital one. of fashion, it still is, cinema, and a lot of young and beautiful women came here in Rome to find their chance in order to become actresses, dancers, or just to meet a rich, a wealthy man and get married. Small apartment in Via Emilia. She also came to Rome dreaming of becoming an actress. Gerda is an ex-dancer. As I was telling, it is 2:30 in the afternoon and Krista enters the villa, the block of flats, to go to visit her friend. The porter, a woman, knows Krista very well and doesn't pay too much attention. She is busy talking to some friends, gossiping and stuff. Krista passes them and takes a lift to go to the 4th level of the building, where her friend Gerda Hodop lives. Suddenly, a blood-curdling scream stops talking to her friend and runs upstairs to see what is happening. The screams continue. A woman is screaming. Everyone in the building is terrified and runs upstairs to see what is happening. Everyone is running upstairs. A single man is climbing down the stairs, very, very calm, wearing blue suit and having one hand in his pocket. People ask him, everyone asks him very worried, what is happening? And he answers as cool as a cucumber, nothing. A woman is screaming, nothing. But when people, first person, succeed to get to the 4th floor, they see Krista step to death, laying down in front of her friend's Gerda Hodab apartment. Of course, they call the police and they call the ambulance. Unfortunately, Krista Wanninger, well, died at the hospital. This case is extremely strange, and not the case itself, but the way in which it was approached by the authorities. It's extremely strange the way in which they closed the case. So the case is considered closed, but journalists still believe that it is an unsolved case, and you will see why. So back then in 1963, Rome was a dream city in which girls, strange girls from all around Europe came to follow a dream. A dream of becoming an actress, a dancer, to find a good wealthy man to marry. Krista Wanninger was one of those girls. Gerda Hodab, her friend, was also one of them. But someone decides to stab Krista Wanninger without any reason. The police first knocked at her friend's Gerda Hodab's door. She didn't answer. She didn't answer the door. She answered the door after they had insisted for a long time, and they wanted to ask her if he knew anything. But instead of answering and giving details, Gerda Hodab asks herself what was going on. She said that she couldn't hear anything because she was sleeping, which is extremely strange. So Krista Wanninger came to visit her. They had previously talked on the phone. They established a certain hour, certain time. But Gerda decides to go to sleep. She said that she had arrived home early in the morning and that she was extremely, extremely tired. And she just went to sleep, and she was sleeping so deeply that she couldn't hear anything outside. She couldn't hear the screams. She couldn't hear the police, the ambulance, the police knocking at her door. All these things seems very strange for the police, and they took her to the police station to interrogate her. And there was also the man in blue, the one who's climbing down the stairs. while everyone was climbing upstairs, he was climbing down the stairs very calm and with one hand in his pocket. Nobody saw that man entering the building. It was a building which had a porter. But everyone saw him getting out of the building. A lot of people describe him, and police drew a sketch. Some said that he was wearing a blue suit. Others said that he was wearing a grey suit. The police also entered Gerda's apartment, and they could see that the apartment had a separate entrance. So, it is very, very strange. They couldn't make Gerda tell anything. She didn't want to tell absolutely anything. The only thing that they could pull out of her mouth was the fact that Krista had a fiancé who was extremely jealous, and that they argued, fought very often. The police found in Krista's back purse 2 notebooks and other notebooks. Also, in her room, she lived in a small room in a guest house in Via Sicilia number 24. Inside the notebook, there were a lot of names of famous people, wealthy, powerful man. From there, they found out that one of the wealthy men in there offered her sums of money every time she needed, and she gave him in exchange something else, you know what I mean. And there were others also. And they assumed that her official fiancé, an ex-football player called Angelo, was jealous, and maybe he couldn't take it any longer and decided to, I don't know, to end his misery. But Angelo had a very, very strong alibi. He was at the barber shop. And when he returned from the barber shop, he saw the people gathered in front of Gerda Hodab's block of flats, and he asked what was happening, and someone answered, "It's nothing, just an American tourist who was stabbed." And he didn't think about that anymore. At the police station, he began crying, and he was visibly affected. prefer to meet different older men who provided for her, and they really argued because of this, but that was it. He accepted, he loved her too much. They argued. That was everything. So Gerda Hodam didn't know anything. She refused to tell anything. Krista's fiancé had a very strong alibi. They visited every person in that notebook. Especially they were old men. And they tried to find out who was the man in the blue costume, because the police assumed that he was the killer. Gerda had been kept in prison for a few weeks, but she totally refused, so they had to let her go. And nothing. They couldn't find any clue, anything. Just a girl stabbed in front of her best friend's door. But in 1964, a journalist called Maurizio Mengoni receives a phone call from a man who claims to be the killer's brother. And then he says that he knows everything on the Wanninger case, but he asks 5 million lire in exchange for the information. Mengoni has time to call the Carabinieri, and they are able to locate a colleague which is coming from a phone in Piazza San Silvestro. It was a public phone, and they arrested in there Guido Pieri, painter, 32 years old painter. They find in his pockets a knife similar to those used to kill Krista. They found in his house a blue suit, four notebooks in which Pieri wrote down some disturbing notes, planning to stab different women, and in which he also confesses killing Wanninger. Moreover, the day of the stabbing, Pieri didn't have any alibi. But the artist says that those written in the diaries were just fantasies. inspired by real facts that he is planning to write a novel, a book, based on Krista's case, and that he really wanted to make some money, taking advantage of the of this famous case not having enough evidence, Pierre is released. He's accused of scamming, but he is released. And guess what? The police throw away old journals, all those notes are thrown away, destroyed. But some copies are kept somewhere in a drawer, but the original was destroyed, and Pierre is released. He gets married, he has a daughter, but in 1971, an ex-marshal from Carabinieri Police, Renzo Mambrini, retires and he dedicates himself to writing a book on this case. The book is called Krista. The book is published, and in the book the author says that Pierre described in his diaries the crime scene with a lot of details that had never been made public. So in 1977, Pierre is arrested again and accused of killing the German motor girl. But this is... he is released in 1978 again for lack of evidence. But arrested again in 1985. And then in 1988 he is accused again, and it is decided that he is the author of the crime. He cannot be arrested because at the moment of the crime he was mentally ill. But meanwhile he cured himself, so he cannot be locked in a mental house, also in a mental hospital. This is the strange part of this case. So you have a mysterious man in blue that is climbing down the stairs after a stabbing had been committed, and nobody follows that man, arrests him. They just let him go. After a year, they found someone who happened to have a blue suit in the wardrobe and who pretended to be a future writer who wants to write a book on Krista's case. But the police let him go again, and they arrest him again. And finally, in 1988, he is being judged, but he's absolved, he's released, because he suffered from mental illness and he wasn't responsible when he committed that crime. But meanwhile, he cured. He is perfectly healthy and cannot be sent to a mental institute, to madhouse, whatever. And the case is closed, so this is the way in which authorities dealt with this case. They found the man in blue or in grey or whatever, accused him of this murder, and then let him go. And the painter has always said that he really didn't have anything to do with Krista stabbing, that he was indeed doing some kind of research in order to write a story, a novel on the case. But as I have told you, in that period when time was called La Dolce Vita's age, women like Krista had a lot of connections. Krista knew a lot of people, a lot of wealthy people. He knew a lot of secrets. He wrote down those secrets in her notebooks. I don't think that a painter just went to wait for her. Went to a random building, to a random block of flats, to wait for a woman to appear, because he couldn't stand women or so. I think someone hid indeed in Gerda's apartment. I think that someone really knew that Krista was coming. And I think that Krista knew something that she shouldn't. That is my opinion. Anyway, the case is considered unsolved in spite of accusing a painter of doing it. Thank you very much for watching. Let me know in the comments below what is your opinion. And see you next time.